Good morning, everybody. How you doing? My name is Dr. Boyce Watkins, and today I'm here with my lovely wife, Dr. Alicia Watkins. How you doing today, babe?
I'm doing great. How are you doing, Boyce?
Doing very well, very well. Yep. And we were thinking about this show called Snowfall, and I wasn't sure if anybody's seen that snow or that show, not that snow, that show. Yeah, so Snowfall is this show that's on FX and Hulu and stuff like that that's really interesting, and I know Alicia is a therapist. You have a lot to say about Snowfall. You've been affected by it.
Yeah, well, first of all, we are late on Snowfall. Like, we just started watching it a few months ago, and we've been binge watching Snowfall for a couple months.
Yeah,
we went through season 1, 2, 3, and we just finished season 4 yesterday. And I woke up this morning, it was like totally on my mind. Oh, what a season finale!
Yeah,
my goodness.
Yeah. It's this show, and first of all, I shouldn't be rude, and I should say, you know, good morning to everybody.
Yeah.
And Dr. Alicia, my wife, we decided we wanted to do something for fun called pillow talk, since we would be laying next to each other on our pillows and having these nerdy conversations. We thought we'd have some nerdy conversations online where you guys can kind of engage with us. And so in this episode of Pillow Talk, we were thinking about Snowfall. We were talking about this show. And just to give you a summary for everybody who might not have seen it, and good morning, Vic and Timothy and Wendell and Damon and Deanna Shepherd and Elizabeth. I want to say hi to everybody and put your B1 in the chat. Put a hashtag B in the number 1 in the chat to let us know you're part of the B1 family. So here's the deal with Snowfall. I'll give you a quick synopsis. Snowfall is a show created by John Singleton that basically does a fictional rendition of what happened in the 1980s, the crack era. You know, how crack was dipped and dropped into the black community and how it caused a lot of problems. The CIA was behind it. The CIA was pushing billions of dollars of crack into the black community. And this destabilized families. This means a lot to me because it ruined our families, it ruined our communities. And also it was just something a lot of us, you know, went through and we hated it. And so give me a yes or no before I hand the mic over to Alicia. Give me a yes or no if you feel that your family was personally affected by the drug epidemic. Did you have somebody in your family that was hooked on drugs? If you have somebody in your family that was hooked on drugs, put a yes in the chat. If you have somebody in your family that went to prison over drugs, put a yes in the chat. My biological father went to prison over drugs. My biological baby brother went to prison over drugs. If you had somebody in your family that was killed over drugs, put a yes in the chat. Creflo and Richard and Dominique and Stephanie and Positive Change and Charlene and Romana and Gerald, I see you. And in fact, if you have somebody that was affected, you can feel free to even write their name in the chat. You know, I say to them, if they're here or not here, just put their name in the chat so we can acknowledge them, because I feel like they were victims of a terrible war. And so I'd like to ask my wife, because I've done a lot of talking. So what are your initial thoughts, you know, as far as Snowfall and what it's done for you?
Well, first of all, I want to send out a ashe to John Singleton, who must have passed away during the making of the last season, or maybe season 3. Mm-hmm. Was it season 3 or season 4? He just died unexpectedly. So big ashe to him.
Yeah. And yeah, I feel like the show changed when he left, too. I feel like some of it lost a little bit of continuity when he left.
It did. When did he leave? I don't know. But I did notice some differences because he had executive producer and had a lot of input into the show. But he had great writers on there. Walter Mosley. Oh my gosh. Walter Mosley has,
shout out to Walter Mosley.
Good grief. He has a book out that is probably one of my top favorite books, and it is called 4/7.
4/7. Okay.
4/7. Oh, gee, it's about slavery. So I know we're all tired of slavery books, but he does it in a way that is like sci-fi, a sci-fi book. And if you can get the audiobook, it's read by Ozzie Davis. And I shade to Ozzie Davis too.
Oh yeah. That's a great
A book read by Ozzie Davis. What a treat.
And just Ruby Dee and Ozzie Davis, just what they represented for the community.
Know what? Ashe to Ruby Dee and Ozzie Davis, because I think they've all gone. They've all passed on. yeah, the other side. They were wonderful.
And that makes you think about Snowfall a little bit more, yeah, because I feel like Snowfall took away the Ruby Dees and the Ozzie Davises in our community. We don't have that. Like, where are the young, like, do we have millions of young people that are trying to become the next Ruby Dee, Ozzie Davis? Like, you know, this quality couple that we can all look up to and admire, mm-hmm, you know, where they're going to be through together through thick and thin. And
well, you know what? In Snowfall, even though it was, okay, crack and all of that, there were some beautiful moments in Snowfall, like the relationship between Wanda, who was on drugs.
I remember everybody didn't see it.
So, not everybody saw it. So there was beautiful relationships even in this show. So Wanda was a lady who dated one of the drug dealers. What was his name?
Leon.
So Wanda and Leon dated each other, but there was something so beautiful about their relationship. Like they were very, so they dated and she would help, you know, make the crack or whatever in the kitchen. She was, mm-hmm, one of the helpers, but she ended up using, and you saw her like really, really fall, but Leon still had love for Wanda, man. You know, he would see her on the streets and he would tell people, don't sell to her. He loved her
through the crack.
He loved her through the crack. I thought that was beautiful. And then he helped her. So she saved his life. I don't want to spoil it for people because this might be too much of a spoiler. But what I wanted to just say is that the beauty of their connection together and how they helped each other come up. Like, she, mm-hmm, saved his life. He saved her life. It was just a beautiful, and then they, you know, bonded together. So there was some really wonderful, even though in the crack era, I mean, these weren't Ozzie Davis and who was Ozzie Davis' wife?
Ruby Dee.
This was not a Ruby Dee Ozzie Davis, but the love was like a Ruby Dee Ozzie Davis. Well, I found that in there.
I thought so too. I think that what I would say about the crack era that's represented in shows like Snowfall is it shows how the drugs and the whole drug game became a huge distraction from our natural state of existence as Black people. Like, mm-hmm, in a normal world, Leon and Wanda would have just, you know, had some kids, hopefully got married, and just kind of went through life together as a normal couple. But instead, because of the crack era, you know, Leon's a dope dealer, Wanda's a crackhead.
Homeless.
The kid, right, yeah, and homeless. And the kids are not getting the love they need because their mama's out in the streets doing God knows what, mm-hmm, you know? And that's what I think, you know, it's like, you know, it disrupted our ecosystem. Like, you have a natural, all animals, all including humans, mm-hmm, have an ecosystem where the males get to a certain age and they start engaging with the females and then they reproduce. And, you know, just like, it's like a process, you know? And when you throw a monkey wrench into a situation, it disrupts the process. Like, if you have a bunch of deer in the woods, and the deer have a process, the deer have a way. We, you know, when you do these things when you're a baby, you follow your mama, then you hit adolescence, then you see the females and you start sniffing them, and they start sniffing you, and, mm-hmm, next thing you know, babies are made. So if you drop like a nuclear bomb in the middle of a deer of an area that has a lot of animals, you're going to disrupt that whole ecosystem.
Yeah, nobody wins. And I think the biggest thing, Franklin, he's the head kingpin, and to see his relationship with his parents, that was really interesting. Like, it was really, there was some storyline holes. Okay,
Franklin is the
bitch drug dealer. I just said that.
Right.
And he fell out with his father, who was a Black Panther, by the way. I mean, so it was really like, what could have happened if the Black Panther wasn't invaded by the CIA? So they let that storyline out. You know, the CIA had operatives in the Black Panther, which we all know by now.
Mm.
But it's just interesting how it just made that whole thing collapse. What would have happened if the Black Panthers in Oakland and California, which they were really strong out there, they did a lot of great things out there. What would have happened had they been able to thrive? It would have been really interesting.
Yeah, well, you know, well, that's true. The dope dealer's father being a Black Panther and having experience with the CIA, that was an interesting twist. It was like, mm-hmm, he was telling his son, like, you need to look out.
You're not going to win.
Yeah, this is what these people do. And,
yeah.
You know, and it was interesting how they sort of made the decision of Franklin to become a drug dealer like a militant kind of activity. Like, he's, you know, he didn't want to be enslaved by the man. He wanted to be free and independent. And so drugs, he felt, was his way to kind of do that.
Yeah, and not follow any rules. He was like, I'm not following rules. I'm not following rules of society because society hasn't followed rules for me. And so he had that sort of rebellious streak. But it was short-sighted.
And you know what? Mm-hmm. If you think about it, go ahead. I'm sorry.
No, go ahead. Go ahead.
If you think about it, it was, it would have been a good story if the crack wasn't so terrible.
I know. You had to get past the crack part.
Like, no. But that's the thing. Think about it, right? The Kennedys, the Kennedy family is worth billions of dollars. And they started with bootlegging liquor. So I'm wondering if people like you and I both are friends with Freeway Ricky Ross. Who really, I think that's Freeway Ricky Ross's story.
That's his story.
I agree with him when he says, you know, he feels like Singleton and the rest of them kind of took his story. Everybody's taking stuff from Ricky Ross.
They took his name. A rapper actually took his name.
Yeah, I know. That still baffles me. You got a rapper. If I saw a rapper run around talking about my name is Boyce Watkins, I'd be like, you motherfucker. You know, like, I don't know. That's crazy.
I don't know. I'd like an MC Dr. Alicia. What?
MC Alicia.
You can have my name. That'd be kind of cool. MC Dr. Alicia, Alicia MC.
Okay, that would be interesting to watch.
Little Boyce.
Oh, little Boyce.
Little Boyce.
Said little baby. Little baby Boyce. There we go.
Oh, that's cute.
Yeah, yeah. Mm-hmm. But you know, I think, you know, if you think about it, right, I have some compassion for those who were involved in the crack game who didn't know that crack was so bad. Like, now maybe once they knew it was that bad, you know, then at that point it's kind of like, whoa, you need to think about what you're doing to your people. But I just really can see where they might have been thinking, okay, this is just like alcohol. This is something that people are just going to do for fun. Because alcohol, I don't know if people know, how many of y'all knew this? Give me a yes or no. Did y'all know that alcohol, not crack, not heroin, is the most dangerous drug in the world? Did y'all know that? That alcohol is, according to most research, look it up. Mm-hmm. Alcohol is the most dangerous drug in the world because they make you think it's okay. And everybody does it. And what happens is millions of people die from drunk driving accidents, alcohol poisoning, you know, liver damage, things that they do while under the influence of alcohol. So alcohol actually is the most dangerous drug because of its widespread use. But I think with crack, I think if it had been just this thing where the high was really intense and you enjoyed it, and then you just went on about your life.
Oh no.
It would
There's
have been
no experimentation
deal.
When it came to crack. It was just like you use it one time and you are totally hooked on it.
Yeah. Yeah.
And you're not yourself. You're just like just interested in that high, chasing that high. And isn't that the best thing you can do to a group of people who are oppressed? You know, just give them a quick outlet and something to just be totally addicted to. Isn't that just like, oh, that's a great recipe for drug. And today, I mean, heroin is really bad right now. Heroin, that's what people call it. Heroin is really bad.
Yeah, I've actually heard people that use crack saying that it's better than sex, which is a scary concept.
Pleasure points. It hits your pleasure. It goes, because of the way they freebase it, it goes straight to your brain, straight to your pleasure points.
Oh, really?
It's really terrible.
Yeah, well, you're an expert on addiction, too. You taught classes on
expert on addiction.
Well, haven't you taught classes on addiction?
Yeah, I have taught classes on addiction. Yeah, with alcohol, you lose brain cells when you drink, and you'd never get them back.
Wow. Anthony says, I was a crack addict. Wow. Shout out to you, Anthony.
Oh, my God. Yeah, so I think that's a great testimony, because people who can overcome crack and their addiction to crack, I mean, that's a huge thing. So, and it takes several attempts of recovery, you know, so that big shout out to him. Who's that? Thank you for disclosing it.
Everybody clap for Anthony. Give him a digital clap, because this brother, God bless you, man. I have much respect.
I wonder if he's seen Snowfall. So like watching Snowfall, was there were moments, right, boys, where we were just terror. It was a horror story.
It was.
I said, we have got to turn this TV off.
Yeah, I got to the point when season 4 started, I had to stop watching for a minute because I was sick to my stomach and pissed off. And traumatized.
Yeah, it was really bad.
Like, I didn't like seeing like my Black community just falling apart, and it's still everywhere. It still affects us to this day. Because now it's part of the culture. Now we got rappers that rap about getting high and marketing drugs, right? Hip hop is a more powerful form of marketing than a TV commercial. So when you're running songs that are very popular with children, and they're talking about, you know, popping pills and using drugs, that's going to have an impact, you know. And I didn't enjoy when they had that Columbia professor Carl Hart that went on The Breakfast Club and was kind of talk about drugs like it wasn't a big deal. Like, oh yeah, you know, I use a little meth just to let the edge off, and a little heroin helps me get through the day. You know, a little coke to just kind of, you know, kind of relax a little.
No, coke. Oh, now coke
pick me up.
Now coke is like in the morning. You would take that in the morning. Right. I say heroin, you probably, or meth maybe at night to calm down.
Yeah, and my thing is like
he's got his cocktail. But of drugs. You know what?
I think I remember DJ Envy was not impressed by any of that.
And, nobody should be impressed.
And I wasn't either. Because I think what it is that if you've been traumatized by it, mm-hmm. right? If you've seen somebody you love go down because of drugs, I don't know about everybody else, but I don't play that shit at all.
Yeah, well, I mean, there are functional addicts out there. There are people who are alcoholics, but they can get up every day and go to work and they function. I mean, they functional. I use air quotes when I use the word functional, but there are a lot of people who just, that's what they need every single day. There are people addicted to the cell phone. Mm. Who am I talking to?
Oh, well, you know, I ain't going to be out here abandoning my babies for the cell phone. And
that's true. And well, yeah, I guess it's technically
getting
not
on my
addiction.
Hands and knees doing God knows what to get a cell phone. No, that's where I can draw the line. But I agree, there are lots of things that hit our that release those endorphins, hit our pleasure points, right? Some more harmful than others, right? So I think
even just more harmful, some more socially accepted than others. So there are a lot of people who are just addicted to work. You know, they just they bury themselves into their into their work, and they don't pay attention. They haven't developed. They haven't made a family. Their children are being neglected. You know, their wives are being usually husbands are, or men are usually like, you know, they're just addicted to the type of work that they do.
And I can see that.
Yeah. So, and you know, so people do suffer. So there's all types of addictions. Some are more socially acceptable than others.
I agree. You know? I think some are more socially acceptable. I do believe some are more harmful than others.
Yeah. Oh,
like
sure.
If I had a choice between being a workaholic and a crackhead.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, being a crackhead has very few rewards. You know, it'd be different if you got the high from smoking crack and you still look the same. You don't look like a crackhead. Mm-hmm. And let's say on top of that, you become really wealthy, you know, because you're, you know, somehow, you know, like workaholics become wealthy and they tend to be successful and have awards and accolades. I think that would be a different kind of addiction than like something that where you just get a little personal high and then your teeth start falling out and you start looking crazy and you might die, you know. On the Tuesday, right?
Yeah, well, whenever you're trying to look at something really outside of yourself to fulfill you and to show have meaning and stuff, that's always a problem.
That's so true.
A problem when you ever do that.
Yeah. By the way, everybody, Alicia and I, this is a segment we do called Pillow Talk. Mm-hmm. And if you could take a second, could everybody take a second and please hit the thumbs up button or subscribe to whatever platform you're on. Please subscribe so that we can keep building Black-owned media. And out of respect for my beautiful wife, I'm going to mention that she's a licensed therapist. And so when she talks about things like addictions and, you know, how the brain works, she's not just talking from the cuff. She's a full professor of social work. And her Instagram tag is Coaching with Dr. Alicia. So you can feel free to follow her at Coaching with Dr. Alicia or coachingwithdralicia.com. She sees clients and all that stuff. So feel free to take a look there if you want to. Okay, so Vic says that he was drinking to deal with his depression.
Yeah. Oh,
and I imagine during the pandemic, that was kind of a problem. I saw during the pandemic, mm-hmm. there was a 30% increase in
alcohol.
In overdose deaths.
Oh, boy. Yeah, isolate people. Yeah, that makes sense. People are isolated. I mean, you have to be. Can you imagine just being afraid to leave your house because media told you it's dangerous to leave your house and you're just sitting there isolated away from everybody? Not even were overdoses high, but like depression rates were high. I had so many clients. I couldn't take any more clients during the pandemic. It was just like, I'm full. Please do not give me anybody else. I'm done. I can't. It was a wait list. It was just so many people and they were just dealing with so many things and couples, my goodness, relationships.
Just all over the place.
It was all over the place. But how did we get through? How did we get through the pandemic, Boyce?
I just made a promise not to kill each other.
Was it really that bad?
It wasn't that
bad. Was it?
I mean, the benefit is you get to know each other. You all get to know each other better because we're here. The kids are here. We're all having to talk to each other. And we were lucky because our house is big enough that we can have our own space.
Yeah, I can't imagine being in some cramped space with children who barely want to do remote learning, barely want to get on, you know, and I feel bad for some of the parents who had to leave work, who had to leave the house to go to work. And then they have to meanwhile worried about whether their kids are like really doing, because you get these real mean emails. Your child is not in class. And they, in text messages, like they were on us.
I think the way it was all handled was just kind of weird and stupid. The pandemic was like Snowfall. It's like this government operation that completely messed up our lives.
It sure did.
You know, and it's like, I think that there was sinister behavior behind all of it. I think it was BS. And, you know, I think there were things they knew that they didn't tell us, and we're just kind of playing a game, and I didn't like it, because it was the worst part about the pandemic was it was during an election year. And I wonder how they would have handled it if they weren't trying to get Trump out of office. If it was just a regular year, nobody's running for office, I wonder how they would have handled the pandemic would have been different than the way they handled it, given that they were trying to win an election.
Yeah, it's interesting you bring up the government, because that CIA agent in Snowfall was just really interesting. First of all, he represents the government. Like, in our mind, he represents whiteness.
He does.
And it was like the coldness in his own family. So they showcased his own family and how nasty and cold family of origin was.
He called his father sir. And so his father was like this patriotic military colonel.
Just toxic. His father was toxic. His mother was absent. So he himself didn't come from, in our mind, we have to say this represents the white person, the white man, in our head, psychologically. That's what he represents. So he represents coming from this coldness. And we know black families aren't cold like that. Like, you know, traditionally, we're nice, warm. We're very loving. We very hug each other. I know in my family, everybody got hugged. Everyone got hugged, and we fed you, and the mother was the central part, and the father was very strong. So I know in black families, traditionally, you know, there's usually a lot of love there, but in these white families, not so much. And so he represented that. I'm talking about culturally, not specifically.
I can see
You know, that was a big theme for me, that he came from this sort of coldness, and he just permeated that all over the South Central LA.
That's true.
You know, that's typically not something like a mama is going to be a mama, right?
That is so true. You're right. I you know, I'm not going to, you can't generalize all white families.
No, we can't. We can just talk about things.
Well, I had a white best friend when I was in high school, and his family was completely different from ours.
Yes.
Some of the stuff they would do toward each other would have me like, what? Or like the kid, you'd be like, did you just cuss out your mama? Anybody ever have the white friend that cussed out their mama like, fuck you, mom?
Yeah.
You know, and you're like, what?
You're like, uh-oh. You're going to get beat down.
Yeah, like, you're going to die today. Your mother's going to murder you.
And that mama had no control.
And bury you in the backyard. Like, right. You know, like we didn't, you know. And then another thing that my white friend did. Now, this, they might have just been special white people, but they would, I would have dinner at their house, and they would use really long words that college professors use.
Oh, no. We use that in my household.
That's right. Well, your daddy was a professor.
My dad was a college professor, so we use college professor. No, I don't think you purposely use long words. I think that's just kind of bizarre.
Oh, okay. Well, you know, Adventure Man has a question. He has a question for you.
What did he say?
He says, I think this would be a good, I'd love for you to answer this. He says, Dr. Alicia, why do you make boys wait so long to earn your attention? Because that's that Kwame Brown propaganda that people
Kwame Brown said that about us?
People, yeah, but they did whole videos about us. Yeah, we're famous on the internet.
Oh my God.
Negroes love to talk about shit they don't know nothing about. So tell
Boys. Okay, first of all, I just want to say, like, I am really honored by that somebody would actually take out time in their busy day, because I'm so busy, I would not have time to do a 3-minute conversation about somebody else's relationship like that. Yeah, so I feel really honored.
That's a good point.
I want to accept my award. I want to thank
my mama.
I'd like to thank my mama for the attention. Like, that is amazing.
No, but answer the question.
Okay, so I got to answer. So he wants
to know, why did you make me wait so long to earn my attention? Because people, I guess that's the, it really shows, you know, I guess, unfortunately, a lot of people don't think for themselves. They don't validate information. If somebody with a big platform says that they think it's true, even though they don't know that the people that talk about us, most of them, they've never met us.
That is just like so great. I'm really loving that, but this is
where some of those.
So comments,
I'm okay with addressing his questions because uh-huh. he didn't seem to be asking it in a disrespectful way, maybe he was. But I think like a question like that, like I'm cool with. But like when people say things that are just outlandishly weird, I'm like, okay, I'm not even gonna pay attention to that. But tell people, for those who care, for the smart people that really want to know the truth. You know, other than what, you know, maybe Kwame Brown might have said about our relationship, again, which Kwame has never met me. He's afraid to talk to me on the phone. I've offered to talk to him. I've been like,
he ain't afraid to get on YouTube.
I've been like, why don't you? No, that's the thing. There's some people who
you hide behind.
There's some people who will talk about you.
Oh,
but have a fear of talking to you. That's because the internet lets people throw a rock and hide their hand. They could throw a rock. And then when you say, okay, well, let's talk about the rock you just threw. Like, how about we just get in the same room? And say that to my face. Let's talk, you know.
Ooh, say it to my face. Right. Ooh, I love it.
Yeah. And
what you gonna say now?
And I think there's something, you know, and I got that from my father. My father's like, if you talk about somebody and they say, can you repeat that right to my face? Mm-hmm. You know, then if you can't do that, then that kind of, you know.
Yeah, so I mean, that's not a.
So why don't you answer the question first?
Okay, I have to answer. What was the question?
The question was, why did you wait so long to get to give me your attention?
Wait, well, we've always had each other's attention.
Right, we've been friends for a long time.
Okay, so I don't understand the question.
Yeah, that's exactly the reason. I think the reason you don't understand the question is because the question don't make no damn sense.
It doesn't make sense. So
it's stupid.
Wait so long. So like, you're my friend from when I was 19 years old. I kept up with you, and I kept up with you and your life and all the things that were happening to you and all the ladies you dated. And it was just fun keeping up with you. So I always kept up with you.
Yeah.
I did not know in terms of like, it is weird because some of my friends thought that you liked me back in the day, but I never thought that you liked me.
Mm-hmm.
I really didn't assume. Did you like me back then or did you not? How'd you feel? Tell me.
I thought you were gorgeous when I first met you. And at that time, I was your friend, and I'm not gonna lie, I was a little shy when I was 22. I didn't know what to say. I met the most beautiful woman in the world.
Gosh.
And at 22, I ain't gonna lie, I didn't really know how to talk to women. I didn't have like my father taught me a lot about manhood from watching him, but one thing he never taught me was how to approach girls.
You know, I don't know if fathers teach their sons how to approach.
I think
that's more like your friends.
Right. And I didn't have a lot. I've never had a ton of friends.
Okay.
You know, and when I would get with my boys, we were on the track team together. I don't remember.
You talk about girls?
We did, but wasn't.
The girls track team didn't work out at the same time. You'd be like, ooh, look at her.
You know what? I just never got that opportunity. I've never been a guy who hung out with a bunch of dudes. Why not? I don't know. I would just have like one good friend.
Oh, me too. Be me
and my buddy, and that would be it. And me and my buddy didn't really, he didn't know anything.
Neither one
of us knew shit. Yeah, neither one of us knew anything. Like, but that's the funny thing. Like, here's the funny part though. Uh-huh. He's super successful. My white best friend, I told you why I used to go to his house and they would do weird white people stuff.
Uh-huh.
And now he's like a millionaire. Like, so we both became millionaires. Like, But people in the neighborhood would be like, oh, those two kids, those are two good kids. And they would see us like training for track, and we didn't get in trouble. We didn't do like dumb shit, you know? And I think, so we were focused. We weren't getting into stupid stuff, but I kind of wish I had learned a little bit more, you know? What do you think?
Okay. So here's the thing, but you got women though, boys.
Well, eventually,
you got women.
Well, when you make money and stuff.
No, like, I'm talking about easy. When you were 22, you didn't have a penny in your pocket at 22. But you was getting women. What's up with that?
Well, you know, I mean, I don't know, I guess.
So if you couldn't talk to women, you said something to get the women that you had back then.
Well, you know, I think that specifically answered that question that he asked. I think it's like, you know, I think the big thing, and not that it's something, you can't explain everything to everybody who wants to say something crazy. Some people just say stuff because they just want to be negative, but generally speaking, you know, this idea, this narrative, I was wondering where this narrative came from, that I was sitting there waiting for you It just came from people just made it up.
People just made it up.
That's what the internet does. People make things up.
Oh.
And then they say those things and people say, oh, it must be true because he said it.
Okay, so because we talk about it right today, what's the date today? The 15th or something?
July 15th.
Because we talked about it today, July 15th, that means we squashed it. No one's going to say anything.
No, else. That's not. No, they're probably
so gonna, it's gonna keep no, going.
They're probably
going
to say more now because people like to see people beef and stuff.
Ah, so that makes us more legendary.
So here's what Blessing Alexander says. Kwame Brown says something about you and your husband's relationship because your husband says something about him first.
What did you say about him?
I said, remember I did the video on the car? And you didn't like it because you felt like he liked to attack everybody and you were like, don't do that. But the thing was, I didn't say anything negative about him. So there's plenty of people that say my name, but Blessing Alexander, somebody saying your name does not mean that you should be offended.
So we're not allowed to say his name?
Well, we just said it. I'll say anybody's name. But the thing is that it's
what is that?
Well, what it is it's like it's just silly talk, you know, because the thing about it is that Ron Artest, people that played basketball with Kwame, literally at the Wizards, like one guy called me and said, you didn't say anything negative about him. Like from his video, another guy called me, a prominent sports commentator called me and said, from what he said about you, I thought that you had just dissed him and attacked him. And then I went and watched your video and you were very polite and supportive. And I think that he just misinterpreted everything that you were saying.
See, that's how problems happen. And see, let's go back to Snowfall because that's how we saw a lot of mishaps in Snowfall. These drug dealers would be beefing with each other, and half the time they didn't even get the whole story. They didn't even understand. Like, people don't, like, at one point you're just like, dude, let's just sit down and talk about it and squash the beef. Nah, everybody's dead. Have these people lost their lives because people can't sit down and understand. And here you got like the kingpin, Franklin, saying, dude, this is business. We got to do what's right for the business. So you felt sorry for like why these beefs happen in the first place. And you see the both sides of the story. And in your mind, you're frustrated because you're saying, look, y'all on the same page. Why are you all fighting each other when really it's, it really, you should be fighting the system. But anyway, it that sort of thing just reminds me of how frustrating Snowfall was at some point.
Yeah, well, you know, a lot of times Black people don't, you know, I think just generally, one thing I also did like about the whole drug game and all that is it brought a lot of violence into the community. It brought a lot of chaos into the Black community where people will fight and kill each other first without actually sitting down and figuring out.
Yeah, because the Black Panther lost control of the community. Like at one point the Black Panther was doing really progressive things and helping people out. And because of the CIA, the Black Panther just lost it.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and then you have this oppressed group. It's really awful.
Well, you know, I kind of feel like and if you look around, it's not like that's the past. You know,
sometimes
we get in this habit of thinking like, oh, that's the past, it's over. And the truth is, you know, if you listen to the music, it's all about dope, the dope game. Dope. While those rappers rapping about either taking drugs, selling drugs, or whatever. Well, it's because they put that dope in the Black community. And this is like the second and third generation of that, right? Their grandparents were on dope, you know. And so the other thing is, if you just kind of look at families, you know, there was a time before Snowfall, you had most Black children had a mother and a father in the house.
That's what I loved about the season finale, because it showed how wonderful of a father Franklin's father was to him and how he looked at his father for direction. Like they had a good relationship before he was an alcoholic, right? So before he got, again, a drug, took him away from his family, how wonderful he was. Like he did a great, like the speech he gave Franklin when he had, was in trouble at school, and just that restoration. I don't like the way that ended. I won't give that away, but you know, the way that ended was really awful. I also felt like because Franklin was bringing in the money, he took on that patriarchal role where it just looked awkward to me that, okay, how come
the son became the daddy because the son was making the money.
It seemed strange. Like I'm thinking, okay, these are two parents living in this house. They need to be in control of their child, you know? So it should have been.
Well, they
should have been a little better.
Well, they made the storyline awkward when the parents were like taking all that drug money anyway. When they first they
just were all of a sudden, so they started a new season. So I don't know. I hate to spoil it for people who haven't seen it, but how are we going to start a new season with the mom not on board, and then all of a sudden the mom is like, not only on board, but she's doing the books. She's doing like she's helping him launder that money through. Through real estate or whatever that they had, the little business that they had. I mean, they eventually explained it, but like I was really confused. It just didn't make sense to me.
Yeah, I think it's more like you know, this remember it's a fictional show, right? So we gotta remember that. But I think it's a good show.
Right? It's an excellent Snowfall. Show.
Like I would recommend it. It'll keep you on the edge of your seat if you're into that kind of thing.
Oh, and then the way they ended every episode on the cliffhanger, you're like, next episode, let's go.
Yeah, and the characters felt real. Like, you know, when I saw the black people on the show, I know black people like that. Like,
I know Leon. I have a Leon.
Yeah, everybody knows Leon. Everybody, you know Franklin. You know,
I have a Wanda.
You know Wanda
and Mel.
We know the mama
and Mel
the crackhead. Yeah,
who turned into the religious zealous?
Who became super religious? Yeah, what is that about people to getting off drugs and become super religious? It's like they're trading one addiction for the other.
Yeah, of course, but this keeping them together. So,
well, some people need their Jesus to hold it together.
Hold it together,
and I don't blame them. Like I really am okay with that, because if you are addicted to your Bible, to me that's a relatively harmless addiction, as long as you're not hitting people over the head with your Bible.
Well, some people do. People hit people over the head with it, and you can be a little self-righteous.
Right. But most of the Christians I know they love is like their favorite word. And ain't nothing wrong with the word love. Ain't no wrong with some loving in the world, you know. And most Christians I know are not people that are gonna condemn you for your mistakes, because they, you know, because they teach you about forgiveness and not judging and all that. But you are right. You are right, though. I mean, in the church, sometimes you do find just extraordinary hypocrisy. You know,
there's a lot of dysfunction in some of these.
Oh yeah, churches. A lot of sexual dysfunction. You know, so
I'm just talking about how they run and operate. Sometimes.
Sometimes, right?
Sometimes, not. We can't make a blanket statement.
We can't. We absolutely can't, right? But I think that if, you know, whatever it takes for people to hold it together, I'm all for that, as long as you ain't hurt nobody.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and Lawrence says some need Jesus, some need Allah. True, true, true.
Okay, whatever it is, Allah. Yeah, Allah helps.
Yeah, divine love says most I know are judgmental secretly. That is so true.
They are judgmental. They can be.
Yeah, let's see. Matt asks, is this TV show enrichment for black people, or is it just showing much of the same stuff we don't want to reproduce?
That's the hard part.
You know, I can hear that, right? There were times where my stomach would start turning because I'm like, I can't watch this. This is just too much. It's too real. But at the same time, I'm glad they have, you know, this theatrical documentation of the extent to which the CIA went out of their way to just destroy, you know, the black community. But it wasn't even like they were just saying we're going to do this so we can harm black people. It's like we were collateral damage.
Yeah,
you know, and that's why I tell black people not
killing two birds with one stone, for sure.
Yeah, for sure. But also it's more like they got into this whole fighting communism thing, so they're funding this war in Nicaragua, and it's illegal, and because Congress didn't approve it, so they're like, okay, let's sell crack. That's a good way to get the money, you know. And I kind of think that it just says to, you know, it reminds me, my theory on black people is we got to stop getting involved in the white man's wars, you know, like getting involved in the Democrat Republican back and forth.
What?
Or getting involved, you know, because whenever you get in the middle of a bigger war, you always end up being a pawn on somebody else's battlefield.
Mm-hmm.
You get played, you get stomped, crushed out. And the U.S. government and just generally like white folks in America that are in the power structure, these hoes ain't loyal. Like, these hoes are not loyal. So what they'll do is, and they've done this all around the world, they'll make a lot of promises to say, hey, if you do this for us, we'll have your back, right? Like Franklin on Snowfall felt like, well, now that I got the CIA having my back, I'm going to be good. And his dad was like, no, when they're done using you, they're going to throw
you out.
They're going to throw you to the wolves. You don't think they'll abandon you in a second? And look throughout history. In Vietnam, we told the Southern, the Viet Cong against the Vietnam. We're the Viet Minh. We told the Viet Minh, we'll have your back. We got your back. They were sending military equipment, all this other stuff. And then when Congress was like, oh, well, we're squeamish now. We don't want to do it anymore. That led to the fall of Saigon. And people were getting killed in the street. People getting their heads chopped off because they thought the government would have their back, didn't have their back. In Nicaragua, they showed that in Snowfall. When the U.S. government got squeamish and they found out about the illegal war and they weren't going to support them anymore and get the weapons to them, what happened? Those people started getting slaughtered. And they're pissed. They're like, wait a minute, you told us you'd have our back and you didn't. Pay attention now. I'm connecting the dots. Come to current time right now. Right this very second, I read an article yesterday about Afghanistan, where they're having to evacuate people out of Afghanistan because in Afghanistan right now, if they find out that you were working with the U.S. government, there are people that are going to come for you and your family right now. Yeah. This is Joe Biden is dealing with this right now. Because they decided that we'll go see the U.S. government is like, they remind me of my raggedy ass cousin. I had a raggedy cousin who would go start shit, but he never finished anything he started. He would go jump in a fight and get everything out of control and then get you into the fight because he's your cousin. So you're supposed to have his back. And then next thing you know, he'd be gone and you'd be in there fighting by yourself. That's what the U.S. government does. They'll start something, but they don't stick to their commitments.
Well, what they're doing is that they're fighting for their own interest. Yeah. And so you really need to know your place. And I don't think that they are apologetic about it. And they definitely don't lie about that part. Like, we're only going to be out for our own best interest. You handle your own thing. And there are many conversations. I think it was really good. Pay attention to those conversations that Franklin had with that Reed, the CIA agent, the things that they said to each other. It was understood. Like, I'm only going to help you as far as I can. I'm only going to help you. I'm only going to be there for you as far as it's in my interest and the interest of the American government to help you. Outside of that, I'm not going to help you. I mean, he was not, he didn't mince words. And then I thought, like, we're not talking about the Hispanics. Really interesting how the Mexicans and the Colombians, like their role in it, which they had a very small role that last season, but that was another thing, almost like the deceitfulness that I saw among the family members with the Latinos family. I thought that was not very culturally appropriate.
Yeah,
because they stick crazy together.
Well,
it's just interesting.
Yeah, but remember, the standard Latino family is not being hit by a drug kingpin sending $1 billion worth of cocaine a year into the U.S. Right. So that's
they had their own connect, right? Or no?
Right, right, right. But I'm saying though, these were drug families. These were not typical Latino families.
Okay.
You know, or Latinx or Latino, whatever.
What is the word now?
They call it Latinx. I don't use that term. I'm sorry. I think that's stupid.
Well,
I'm sorry.
I don't know if it's necessary.
Latino, Latina. I'm okay with that.
Whatever people want
to
use.
Until they make it illegal for me to say that, I'm not going to say Latinx.
Latinx.
But I'm sure that the cultural appropriation police or the political correctness police are going to come along. And,
well, the thing is, let them decide. If they want you to say Latinx, then just say Latinx, boys.
No, you say Latinx. I'm going to be quiet. What do you think about the pressure of getting shot from the government? Of getting the shot from the government, asked Geraldine. What do you think about that? That pressure of getting the shot?
Man, the more you pressure me, the more you don't want to do it. Like, why are you so interested in me
getting the shot? I'm a believer that everybody has the right to make their own decision. And what I don't like is when people who get the shot are shaming people who don't get it. And attacking them, you know, like Gail King said she wasn't going to invite people to her to Thanksgiving if they didn't get the shot.
But what difference does it make to her?
Right. Well, to be,
if you're vaccinated, what difference does it make if someone else is not?
Right. And that's the part that people are laughing about. They're like, wait, but you're protected. So why do you care? But what their argument would be is they would say, yeah, but the shot's not 100% effective. So if you are not, if you don't have the shot, your odds of having the virus is higher. So that changes.
No, wait a minute. I thought getting the shot helped you protect you from that Delta variant that's supposed to be coming around, that's supposed to kill everybody.
I don't know.
I'm getting these mixed messages. What's up?
I just know that people should be allowed to make their own choice, in my view.
Yeah,
you know, with their own consequences. And I also believe that you got to look with media. I believe you got to look at the fine print I'm convinced media and government kind of work together to pursue these really weird agendas. And if you look at the fine print, like I look for little things like when you're trying to tell me how dangerous a virus is, tell me exactly how many people died. If you notice when they talk about the Delta variant and all that, they talk about the number of cases, but they don't really talk much about the number of deaths. And there's a big difference there because if I was to ask how many of you, yes or no, know somebody that caught the virus, most people know somebody who caught it. There's a lot of cases out there. Mm-hmm. But if I say how many of you personally are directly related to somebody who died from the virus, that number would be a lot lower. It doesn't mean it doesn't happen, though, right? It doesn't mean you ignore it. But it does mean that there's a difference there. And so when they don't have the heavy artillery is death. To scare people, to really scare people, you tell them somebody died, right? And they used to be able to do that. But then when those death numbers started dropping, they were like, well, we can't scare them with the number of deaths. Because there's fewer people that die from that virus in the U.S. than there are kids that got shot in Chicago last week, the deaths don't scare them. So let's just use number of cases, and then we won't even bring up the word death in the article. So I want to know the difference, right? I'm with Gladys. I'm not making fun of anybody who disagrees. Like Gladys says, she says that cases and deaths are different, and I agree. I want to know about the number of deaths because the number of cases. It's not something that necessarily scares me because
but they do scare you because they say things such as people who have gotten coronavirus and gotten over it, there's long lasting health effects. So they're trying to tell you that your heart is never going to be the same. You're never going to breathe the same. You're never going to be the same. Mm-hmm. You're going to always struggle with some of these issues. Oh my God. Someone I know told me that if you catch coronavirus, you're
don't say coronavirus.
Oh, that's right. I'm sorry. That's right. We can't say that. Okay. Yeah. If you
say the virus, or if say you the catch shot, it. Say the virus, the shot. Don't use the V word.
Can I say the shot though? I should say something different. Oh, you're right. Okay. So if you catch it, that your life expectancy shortens by 2 years. Someone told me that.
Mm. Now, Lawrence Bradford Ross says, my mother-in-law and a good friend died from it. I have family in Namibia worse than the world. So Lawrence is making a good point, right? So some people have been hit by it. And, you know, my heart goes out to those people, right? And then what I also ask in some cases is I say, well, you know, if a person's older, if they're 80, 85 years old, like if you tell me about a 90-year-old person passing, it's not that I'm not sad. You know, it's the end of a long life, but it was a long life. Mm. That's different from a 22-year-old passing.
The thing is let's not say that it's not real. It is real.
It's very real.
It is very real, and it is very contagious. And you really do. We do. So I don't want us just.
Well, what I think the problem to me is that there's a lot of things that are real, and that what they do is they expect you to have selective consciousness about what's real and what's not real. Like if I come to them and I say, you know, over 100 people got shot on Memorial Day weekend in Chicago, they'll talk about it like it's not real. They won't even address it. Mm-hmm. You know, Chicago, the mayor of Chicago should have the city in a state of emergency. She should be putting billions of dollars into all the communities where people are getting shot. She should be doing that right now.
Meeting with the aldermans.
Yeah.
Sorting it out. That's a big issue.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah. But if you go to her and you say over 100 people got shot this weekend, she'll say, gosh, that's unfortunate. But then they'll be like, oh, but you know, 12 people died from the Delta variant.
And then she's going to shut down Lakeshore Drive.
Right. Then we're going to shut down half of Chicago.
Yeah.
Because 12 people died from the Delta variant, but you can't go and have the same sense of urgency when babies are being shot in the street in your own damn city. So that's my problem is stop expecting me to overreact to the things that you want me to pay attention to, but then to have no sensitivity to the things that you want me to ignore. Mm-hmm. You're playing with my head. I don't like that. You know, so anyway, did you have any other thoughts in terms of Snowfall? Speaking of Snowfall, two thoughts I have on Snowfall for you that relate to, one relates to you, one relates to Chicago. You grew up in Gary, Indiana, which was the murder capital of the world at that time on a per capita basis. That was related to drugs. I'm sure a lot of those deaths were drug related. Am I right?
Yeah, it was drug related, but you know, it was more economic because Gary, Indiana used to be thriving with the steel mill. You could graduate from high school, go and work at the steel mill and have a nice 2-car garage house, send your children to college and do awesome things. So Gary used to be like awesome. It used to be great. I mean, that's why my family moved to Gary, was because it was economic opportunity. There were jobs there. And so when the steel mills shut down and there was just no jobs there, it just got, I don't know how terrible it was. But it was prime.
Mm-hmm. Oh, go ahead. I'm sorry. I cut you off.
So what were you going to say?
But poverty alone does not make people want to murder each other. There are plenty of poor areas all around the globe where people are poor as hell. But you can leave your door unlocked at night. So I don't think it's just the poverty.
The economics
can be the driver to make you get into the drug game, right? So when you say to somebody who's poor, hey, you could sell cocaine and take care of your family. Well, of course, they're more likely to do it because they're struggling financially, right? So the economics opens the door for the drugs. Right.
It was just a depressed place. I mean, it started becoming more and more like brain drain. So you go to college like I did and, you know, you don't come back to Gary. What am I doing? You know, so people either move to Indianapolis or Chicago or just move away. They weren't coming back. And the people who were left there were people who just couldn't go. It's just so funny because, like, you know, being raised in Gary, I wasn't born in Gary, but being raised in Gary, it's like so-and-so moved back to Gary. It's like, oh, what happened to them? Like something bad happened to you. You end up moving back there.
Like prison, like escape. Like the movie Escape from New York.
You moved back to Gary. What happened? Well, my mom was sick or my son, you know, it's always like some sad story that made you move back to Gary. But you know, that I think that is important to talk about, that it didn't used to be so bad. Like people would look to Gary for the best. Gary had the best educational system in the country. In the country, people would come to Gary and model their educational system after what we had in Gary, Indiana. And not to mention, come on, we have like beautiful people come from there.
Well, Michael Jackson's from Gary.
That's right. Michael Jackson. Come on.
Michael Jackson's family. House was very small. I was very surprised.
But there was, yeah, of course it's small. But who else? Denise Williams. There's a lot of famous people that come from
Gary. The girl from Players Club.
She's not from Gary.
She wasn't. Oh, no, didn't you
she's
say
from
you had,
Chicago.
You said she came to your house.
No, Chicago. She's from Chicago.
Oh, I thought she came to your house for dinner one time.
No, Chicago. In Chicago.
Oh, in Chicago.
My grandparents' house. She was friends
with
my cousin.
Oh, but you did sit down and eat dinner with her.
Yes.
Oh, that's pretty cool.
Before she went to California. But that's Chicago. We're not talking about Chicago. You're talking about Gary. And Gary, so that's what happened with Gary. And then, of course, it had to have the gangs. And of course it had to, I mean, it just followed everything in the 80s.
Right. So I think that the drugs in the background, I mean, I want people to kind of understand, like, this is not just a poverty thing though. Like when you have, you know, 14-year-olds with AK-47s, that don't happen just because people are poor. It happens because somebody supplied that 14-year-old with an AK-47. Why would they supply a 14-year-old with an AK-47? Well, because when you have the drug game, you have to protect territory. The drug game is a naturally violent game, right? It comes from, you know, the Colombians and Mexicans when they're, you know, fighting over territory to sell. They don't just have, you know, they don't go to court. You know, they go and they clean out that space, you know, by killing people. So that to me is where Snowfall hits Gary, Indiana, because when you talk about gangs and you talk about killing and you're talking about some people having a lot of money, like that's all like connected to the violence. You know, it's not just the violence is an artifact of a specific culture that is being incentivized in that space. Also, remember, don't forget that the music started twisting too, and the music started glorifying the violence. We started glorifying, you know, the dope dealers and all that. And we still do that. That hasn't changed. You know, Rick Ross is a famous rapper because he named himself after a famous dope dealer. And he raps about being a boss and having money as a dope dealer. So that all that culture is like glorified now. And I kind of think we got to look at all that.
Yeah.
You know, like that didn't happen by accident. Yeah. The other thought that I had, too, was in Chicago, you know, when I think about Snowfall, I think about, you know, I used to be involved in a case of a guy named Mario Lloyd, and I knew his daughter, and he sold some dope in Chicago back in the 80s, and you know, and it was crazy because they started using RICO charges to clean out the neighborhood. So that's the insidious thing about the white man, is he'll create a problem and then he'll come and solve it. He'll pay himself to solve it. Like, he'll make himself, like, he'll be the villain and then make himself the hero at the same time. You know, like, same with the grocery store, will sell you donuts at the front of the store and then diabetes medication in the back. Like, we're going to make you sick and then we're going to make you well, right? So basically, after they put all these drugs and guns in the black communities, they then said, okay, we're going to help you. We go to the white man for a solution. So the Congressional Black Caucus actually was one of the key backers of the Bill Clinton crime bill, which Joe Biden backed. They couldn't get it through because there were some people in the Congressional Black Caucus at that time who said, you know, they said, if we do this, we're going to incarcerate so many black people, it's going to destroy a generation. And John Lewis was the guy. I read an article about this from 1994. John Lewis was the guy who got the CBC to get on board with the Clinton and Biden crime bill. So the crime bill gets passed and they start pushing RICO charges onto these families. So what happened with Mario, which happened with a lot of families, is they put that whole kingpin thing on them, which means you and all your known associates can go to jail, right? Anybody who's ever taken money from you, anybody who hooked you up on a phone call, anybody who did any work for you, even for 10 minutes, whatever, can all go to prison too. So they locked up, not just him, they locked up his whole entire family. They sent him to prison. His brother got 20 years. They sent his sister to prison. They sent his mother to prison. And they did this to a lot of families all across, you know, our community. And then those families are hit with horrible generational curses as a result of that.
Okay. Yeah, I mean, it's something. I don't know what, you know, what can we do? I think we need to take our communities back. Yeah. I think we need to start investing in some healing from all of that.
Yes.
I feel like I need therapy just watching Snowfall. just watching what?
I'm fully convinced.
Mm-hmm.
I'm fully convinced every black person needs therapy. What do you think?
Oh, well, of course I think so.
Well, you're a therapist.
I'm biased. But I think you do need to have, like, and I don't want to take anything away from praying. And I don't want to take anything away from, because, you know, I think it's important to pray and to meditate and do some self-work. That's important. But you do need to talk to somebody who has that more objective eye, who can start helping you sort through some of your feelings. Mm-hmm. I think it's important to do that and to give you courage to have your own voice, to set boundaries with people, to And you know, it's really hard for black people because there's so many of us. Like, you know, we do pretty well, boys, but there's just so many of us, even in our families, that aren't doing well. Like, how do we deal with that? Like, that's a tough thing. You know, just day-to-day struggles. Sometimes it can be difficult to deal with. And you do need somebody to talk to. Somebody that you can say things to, and I won't judge you at all for it. I'm going to sit and listen to it, and I'm going to encourage you. So, and come up with some solutions and strategies on how you can have your strong voice and set these good boundaries with people and know that you can fulfill your purpose. Good grief.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, by the way, I want to acknowledge, the No PC show. He says he lost two cousins this week to gun violence.
This week?
Yeah.
Good grief.
Oh my goodness. I'm so sorry.
Those cousins, boy.
Yeah.
Oh my gosh.
Sorry for your loss. Oh, wow. Well, sorry. We didn't mean to depress everybody.
I know. That's so tough, but it's real.
It is very real. It is very real. And speaking of real, my phone is real low on battery juice. And so we got to bounce about it here. But I want to give everybody, here's Alicia's website if you want to go take a look. It's coachingwithdralicia.com, and she actually does couples counseling and stuff like that.
Yes, I'm the B1 couples therapist.
The B1 couples therapist. Okay, all right. There you go. That's good. B1 is important.
Yeah.
And also you can follow her on Instagram at coachingwithdralicia. So feel free to do that. And I really enjoy these conversations. So thank you for hanging out with us for our pillow talk.
Yeah, this was fun. I enjoyed this.
I like the pillow talk. Like, we really are laying on pillows.
We are on our pillows.
We really are on pillows.
And we got a lot of pillows here.
Yes. And I think it's fun because the thing is, pillow talk with two professors is usually a little bit different from just standard pillow talk. We'll be talking about some weird, crazy stuff.
What we talk about, we can talk about weird, crazy stuff.
No telling what day it is. Or whatever, depending on the day.
We're absent-minded professors too, though.
Mm-hmm. So. And then sometimes we just a couple crazy black people would be arguing and stuff. I ain't gonna fight with you today.
We made it through the pandemic, though, boys. I think that's just like great.
Yeah,
we need to have a sticker or a button. Our relationship
I made it through the 2020 pandemic. Yeah, there we go.
Drug free. We survived drug free too.
Nick the Socialist says less church or more action.
Oh, I love it.
I like that. Yeah, my friend has something called Less Talk, More Action. Yeah. Ryan Mack, he had a tour called Less Talk, More Action. I agree. I heard that. All right, guys. So if you could hit the thumbs up button before you go. Thank you, Marvin. And Marvin says he likes the vibe.
He likes our vibe.
Yeah. So maybe we should like at some point go in the studio and get some soft microphones that make us sound like we're on NPR.
Oh, so we can talk really soft like this so that we sound very intelligent and you will believe us.
Yes, when you talk like this and then you pause and allow for meaningful silence, it makes people feel that they're part of a meaningful conversation. Wouldn't you agree, Dr. McLaughlin? Watkins.
Oh, what did you call me? What did you call me? Yeah, and we have to have like wonderful soothing colors, like a soft purple.
So you mean like video? We got to do video.
We
now.
Have to do video. Put some colors in there too.
So we can't.
Clothes are important.
Oh, so we got to put clothes on.
Yeah, we don't have clothes on.
I ain't trying to do all that. I ain't trying to go to work. That sounds like too much like a job.
Yeah, I don't want to have to
got
put clothes
people putting
on.
Clothes on and stuff. All right. Anyway, you guys have a good day. And it was really fun talking to you. And we love you. And God bless you. And please hit the thumbs up button on your way out the door. And by the way, here's my Instagram. If you haven't followed me on Instagram, feel free to follow me. Theo Huxtable follows me on Instagram. Did you know that?
As I found out this morning. He left a comment.
You know what? I like Malcolm Jamal Warner because he is a smart dude. Don't you love it when you meet somebody that you only knew from TV and you find out in real life that they're actually a cool person?
Well, I mean, he was definitely raised by Bill Cosby, right?
I think he was raised by his parents.
Of course, but you know, when you're on that show.
I don't know. I haven't asked him about Cosby, and really? I probably wouldn't.
I thought I saw some interviews where, you know, he talked about how close of a relationship he had with Cosby. Mm-hmm. I thought I heard him say that.
I think that that's a benefit. I really
do.
I think that despite, you know, whatever personal failings Cosby may or may not have had, I personally think, you know, that being mentored by Bill Cosby is, you know, as a boy anyway. And I believe the young ladies would benefit as well.
All the people on that show had a really positive, from what I've seen.
Yeah, what I really liked about Malcolm was when I was, you know, during the last campaign, when Ice Cube and I were doing all this stuff and we were kind of challenging the Biden administration, a lot of black folks would get mad and saying, oh, you're telling black people to not vote. You're telling them to become Republicans, right? None of that was true, right? But that's how propaganda and misinformation works as part of the game. Malcolm took the time to send me a very long Instagram post asking me to explain where I was coming from. And I said, you know, I respect you a lot just for the fact that you took the time to try to understand as opposed to prejudging. And I thought that was great. And he's intelligent. Daryl Bell, who played
Ron. Daryl Bell.
You and I sat and talked to him for hours. And he's a wonderful guy, very smart. You know, so it's really cool. And then also, I never met Felicia Rashad, but in real life, I think Felicia is, she seems to be as classy as Claire Huxtable was on the show. Like, I like that. You know, I really like it when you meet somebody, you find out that they are similar in life that they were on TV. And even Cosby, when we talked to Cosby, you know, he sounded like Bill Cosby.
He did.
Just like an older, tireder version, but that was kind of cool.
He was so funny, and he was sharp.
He told us jokes.
How great is it to have
the joke.
That sort of experience and then to be funny at the same time?
Like, that is so true.
To come out and it did not zap your joy in that way.
That is so true.
It's so wonderful because this world can zap your joy, especially when it beats you up like that.
Oh, that would, right?
You know, how can you
send an 80-something-year-old man to prison to level 5? If you send an 80-something-year-old man to level 5 maximum security prison, you're just trying to waste your money. It costs thousands of dollars a year to put, probably thousands per week, to put somebody in a level 5 maximum security prison. That should be saved for the most dangerous people in society. Ain't nothing that an 82-year-old man can do that's really a threat to society. You could put an ankle bracelet on that motherfucker and put him in his house. Why don't you do that? Make him, force him to sit with his wife for the rest of, be like, look, we know you missed a lot of years with your wife because you run around with them bows. You run around with them little snow bunnies. We going to make you sit next to Camille.
How you going to say snow bunnies? You are wrong.
You know what I would have done? I'm saying, what I would have did to Bill is I would have said, I sentence you to life, the life sentence with next to Camille, and Camille is your warden. She's going to run to jail that you're going to be in, and the jail, but it's going to be a
big... And look at Camille. You know she running it.
Heck yeah, it's going to be a mansion. You know she running it. It's going to be a big mansion, and you cannot leave the mansion. You must be next to your wife, because we're going to put an ankle bracelet on you, and that's it.
That is so funny. You know, he did do a post
recently. Oh, and make you eat healthy food.
Healthy food?
No hoagies and apple pie or whatever.
They feed you good in prison.
No, they don't. So don't say that. That's not
true. Saw the meals. I went
maybe
to jail.
Maybe Bill Cosby got there. Oh, when you worked in the prison. You did work
I did not go to jail.
I don't think
as a jail person, but we used to put like students in the jail.
I ate prison food one time when I went to visit the prison. I didn't like it. It came off, you know what it came off? It came off like a cafeteria with like a high school a cafeteria at a bad high school.
Oh.
The food just didn't I didn't feel comfortable.
Oh. You know? Well, when I went to the jail, they were passing out Sun Chips and they were It was pretty. It wasn't that bad. Well,
the prison I went to, I was surprised.
It wasn't prison. It was jail, though. That's a different. Mm. Mm-hmm.
Well, I don't know. But I remember when I went to one in Detroit, it was a jail. And what made me sad was walking through the courtyard and it was nothing but black men.
Yeah.
You would have thought you was on the campus of a HBCU.
Yeah.
If it wasn't for the fact that they were all wearing the same clothes. But literally, it was full of black men, you know, and that, again, disrupted our ecosystem. Now that's why a lot of black women don't have husbands, is because all their husbands are in jail. You know, the man they were supposed to marry got locked up, you know, 10, 15 years ago. You know, so I think that next step to fixing and to correcting is a consciousness of what happened to us, where we are and where we want to go, and then being committed to getting there, you know. So let's see, Marla said the feds is like Sizzler. Yeah.
Wait, I don't get the joke. The feds like Sizzler?
No, the feds is like Sizzler. Like, the feds are like Sizzler.
I don't get it.
Darlene agrees that we should make, that would be a good punishment. Make Bill stay home with Camille with an ankle bracelet and eat healthy food for the rest of his life.
Yeah, I mean, that would be a wonderful way to build the connection back with his wife. And, it would be great.
It would be an appropriate punishment if you really think he did something wrong. You know, and some people feel like he did. I don't think he was a perfect man, but I don't think he should have been in prison. He should never have been in prison because they did not have evidence. And that is something that people need to stop acting like they don't remember just because he's black. And Sadborn says, stop lying. You don't eat prison food on visits. Well, Sadborn, let us educate you real quick. We didn't just go on prison visits. We were actually invited by the prison to do work in the prison. So when you are invited to do work in the prison, you can, in some cases, end up eating the food that's in the cafeteria. Now, if you're just visiting your cousin Rerun in jail, chances are they're not going to ask you to come into the cafeteria to eat.
So you were invited.
Yeah, we went there. We spoke to the inmates. Yeah, we spoke to them. Yeah,
my dad spoke to inmates one day.
Really? Did he?
Yeah.
Well, your dad was a great social worker and a great scholar.
They said he did a wonderful job as a speaker.
Your father was a strong black man. That's why you picked me.
Ah, what?
You picked me because your father. Really? Yeah, if your father had been a thug, you probably would have thought I was boring. You'd be like, I don't want to be with some guy who reads books. I want a guy who busts caps.
He's boring.
Like, who pops his collar and busts caps on fools. That's what you would want. Right. Oh, but please. Instead, you wanted that man who was strong and masculine, intelligent, and who's going to handle his business.
I didn't think about it like that. Just thought about.
Oh, I think about it all the time. I thank God that your father raised you to be a decent woman, because you think about it, you were pretty. You're always pretty. You're a pretty lady. So you could have dated all them NBA players that were hitting on you. You could have dated some guy in the NFL. You could have dated some thug. You had dope dealers try to hit on you, but you did that. Didn't appeal to you. Why didn't it appeal to you? Because you saw the problems with that kind of lifestyle, and you knew you didn't want to be an NBA wife. You knew you didn't want to be the wife of a dope dealer, because you didn't want to be visiting your man in prison.
I didn't want to be in prison myself.
Right. You don't want to get locked. Yeah, exactly.
There was a dope dealer tried to talk to me.
Yeah. I remember you telling me about that.
Yeah, I was like, no.
Yeah, big money, all that stuff. Yeah, and a lot of girls that don't have that example, they fall for that. They fall for the flashy, and they don't understand what comes with that. And next thing you know, unfortunately, some of them end up dead, or, you know, there are women doing 30, 40 years in prison because of stuff their boyfriend is doing. And they had no idea that he was even doing it.
They were so in love. They got caught up.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, love is a drug. Love is y'all's crack.
Well, it can be a drug, yeah.
When a woman's in love, she is like a crackhead. Like, she loses her damn mind. Love makes my mind. Love makes us all crackheads.
I didn't lost my mind with you, boys.
Right, exactly.
I can't get enough of you.
Got you whipped. You got that whip appeal. Come on in, whip
it. So I'm whipped, right?
Well, I'm whipped over you. I love the hell out of you. I mean, and I think, you know, and I know a lot of men understand that. You know, when you have that, when you're with that woman that you just admired, like, to the end of the earth, you shout it from the rooftops. You don't care who hears it, you know. And anybody who thinks that that's a bad thing, you know, I kind of feel bad for them, because that means they've probably been very traumatized. You know, they like, you know, because usually if a guy says, "Oh, you simping because of that girl," what they're doing is they're reflecting the fact that they had a time where they really loved a woman, and they got their heart broken, and that woman that broke their heart might have been their actual mother, right? So what you do is you protect that soft interior by being hard. You get hard on the outside to protect a soft inside, because if your inside was tough and durable, you wouldn't have to protect it, but you protect it because it's very fragile. So you come out, and anytime you see a man that admires a woman, you're like, "Oh, you being a simp, or what's wrong with you, blah, blah, blah." But if you're truly comfortable, like if you truly know that, like, look, if I get my heart broken, like if you broke my heart, anything can happen, right? If you broke my heart, I know I could bounce back from that. I'd be sad as hell, right?
If you broke my heart, I would not bounce back from it. Well, I'd be so sad for such a long time.
Well, I would bounce back. I love you, but
you would bounce back?
Ain't nobody gonna keep me from eventually picking up.
I wouldn't bounce back. It would be like, "What happened to Dr. Alicia? Oh, she's in the corner somewhere crying her eyes out."
Yeah, and you would do that for about a month, and then you would move on.
That is not true.
You'd be like,
"I would not do that for a month."
Don't listen to her. This lady, like, has run marathons before, and
that's right.
You fought through your PhD program. No, people like you bounce back. You might feel. You would feel the grief. You would feel the grief.
I'd be awful,
and you would process the grief thoroughly. And then, you know, after about 2 months of grief processing, I'd be coming to your house, and you'd be like, "Boyce, I want you to meet Todd." I'm like, "Who the fuck is Todd?"
No, I would not have a Todd. Let me tell you, I would put my wedding dress on, and I would just sit in my wedding dress all day long. And I would cry my eyes out, like Great Expectations. You ever seen that movie or the book?
No.
I've read the book Great Expectations.
No, I haven't seen
it. Miss Havisham was in her dress, and she was mean.
And you would not be, you are not a Miss Havisham.
That's going to be me. I'm going to be Miss Havisham if you break my heart.
No, Miss Havisham is a weak ass woman. You're not weak. You are not weak, man.
I'm going to be weak.
I don't believe that. And fellas, don't y'all believe that when she says, "I would never get over you no matter what." See, that's what, but that's
so
no,
sad.
Seriously, that's what guys get their feelings hurt, because the woman will convince them that, like, I can never get over you, and your penis is the biggest thing I've ever seen. Before you there were none, after you there will be no more. Like, we believe that shit. And then when you act right, or when things don't work out, and then you see her with another man, it's like a shock to your system.
Somebody, I will just be in my wedding dress sitting in this house being mean to people.
See, that
it would
that,
change my whole
I
life.
I appreciate you, the fact that you're telling me these lies, because that's good. That's good. That makes me feel valued, but I don't believe any of that. I'm going to tell you the truth.
Believe it.
I believe that you would have two really bad months.
No.
And then eventually some guy would come along. That's why you protect what you have. That's why every day, I don't take days for granted. I do my best every day to be there for my family, because I believe you always in a competition in a relationship. And, you know, people think that because somebody committed to them that they can just act any old kind of way and there's no threats to their situation. I don't think that way.
Well, I don't operate on whether someone's threatening this situation. Like, I don't operate on that.
Simone
said Todd
would be painting your toes. By the way, Simone, his name was Todd. It wasn't Ted, but I get your point. Yeah, Todd would be painting your toes.
Todd would not be painting my toes.
And I'd be up here plotting to kill Todd, and then it would just be a problem.
Really? But you love me that much that you would get mad?
No, I'm not going to. I would get mad, but I wouldn't go to jail. I ain't going to jail over nothing.
But you know what? I don't, not for one second do I think about whether somebody can take you away from me. I don't think about that. I think about just us. You know, I just think about us and how sad I would be if you broke my heart. That's all.
Yeah. Well, you know, and that's what it is. I think it's, you have, having a healthy appreciation for each other is what you aim for. And then you just see whatever the world, you know, whatever life brings you, you just deal with it, you know? And I don't think anybody should ever be at a point where you can't eventually pick up and recover, you know, from a situation. Like if somebody don't want you, they just don't want you.
Okay. All seriousness. Okay. Mm-hmm. Yes, you can pick up. Yes, you can recover. Yes, you can get your life back. Yes, you can move on. Yes, you can process on how you've learned your lessons with this person, how you can take that and carry on and become whole again. I'm just saying that it, for me and you, because we are so deeply connected, Boyce, I don't think I've ever been connected to anybody as deeply as I've been connected to you.
Oh,
nobody. I think it would just take me whatever, however much time it takes a normal person to get over, just double it for me. I would just be miserable for a really long time. I would be so sad. But I wouldn't let you know I was sad. You would never know. I would keep it from you.
You would have that resting bitch face with me.
No, I just wouldn't keep it. I just wouldn't. I wouldn't let you know. But I'm letting you know that I would be letting me know that awful. You wouldn't let me know.
So if it happens and you're not letting me know, in the back of my mind, I could say she's
just pretending. In the back of your mind, you say she's just pretend. I wouldn't even pretend. You wouldn't even have a chance to see me.
Okay.
I would just be that girl. But you don't let a dude know how you suffer.
Yeah,
because of them. Don't let them know. Have some dignity. But just know that I'm gonna put my wedding dress on. And I'm going to get some tissue, and I'll be crying for a long time.
Well, I appreciate that. Thank you.
So I'm just telling you what I'm.
Thank you for the little ego booster. I appreciate that.
Does that make you feel good? It's true, though.
Well, you know, I think it's like, you know, I'm appreciative. You know, I wouldn't have married you if I thought any less of you.
I'm kind of mad at you because, like, why didn't you try to talk to me earlier? That would have been.
You mean when we were much younger?
When we were much younger, nice.
Well, first of all, I'm not gonna lie. When we were much younger, when I first met you, I was intimidated by your beauty. I didn't know
what.
Because I saw.
I was so scraggly that day.
You were not scraggly.
I threw on sweatpants.
I'm not even gonna hear that. You're the prettiest lady I saw at Indiana University. There was no the whole 2 years I was there, I did not see a prettier girl.
Nobody. Okay, can
no,
I?
No, I didn't. And so
it was completely.
Sometimes
single.
Like guys don't talk about it, but sometimes guys are intimidated. Sometimes guys are like, "Damn, like I don't even know what to say," you know. And I saw, you know, the star of the basketball team was trying to holler at you. I didn't at that time. I think when you're young, you don't know where you fit in, and.
He had a girlfriend. No way I was talking to
him. Yeah, but still, some girls don't care. But the thing is that, like, it's like, you know, I didn't, when you are a guy who, like, I was more into my books and stuff, and I was not, you know, and we live in a world sometimes where you see girls, they'll chase the flashy guy or the basketball player or whatever. And I didn't know. If I'd known that your father was a professor and I'd had a mentor.
You did know, didn't you? Or no,
if I knew or not, but I think that, you know, that if I'd known that how you were raised and how that affected your thinking, I would have probably said more. But you were different. You were different. You weren't like a lot of girls I did meet that did want, like, remember, think about this. I mean, you had chances to date and marry guys that were in the NBA, the NFL, you know, who had a lot of money, all that stuff. But you wanted guys who were smart. And I didn't, I was still coming into myself. It probably wasn't for a few years where I started realizing, okay, wait, intelligence is an asset. It's just as good. It's just as much of an asset as being 6'5". You know, I'm not even 6 feet tall. I'm 5'8". You know, and I didn't have a lot of money then. You know, so you kind of like learn. You just learn. You learn what your swag is, right? And I learned my swag was intelligence. My swag was, you know, that I have a lot of character assets, I believe.
I thought we had fun together when we were friends.
We did. And I really enjoyed being your friend. And the other thing, too, is I have to be honest and tell you, I wasn't in my 20s. There's no way I could have got married in my 20s.
Well, I wasn't saying married. Okay, if we dated in your 20s, mm-hmm. I'm just so curious how... How dysfunctional would we have been?
You know what would have happened if I dated you in my 20s? I would have had a wonderful, amazing relationship with you.
And you think it would have?
It would have lasted about 3 or 4 years.
No, you know what I think? I think it would have been on again, off again. It would have been like, okay, they together today. Okay, what happened now? We get each other mad and stuff. Because I wasn't even a therapist back then. I didn't know. Let me tell you, you test my therapist skills.
Do I?
People just don't know. Boyce, you are ultimate test of my therapist skills. So I bet you back then it would have been like on again, off again. We would have been just a mess, but the connection is so tight between us that I think that once we made that connection, it just would have been crazy.
Yeah, but I'm glad I connected with you later, because when I did finally really connect with you, I was ready to connect in a marital kind of way. I wasn't interested in marriage in my 20s. I wanted to have experiences that, you know, like my parents got married super young, and I didn't think I wanted to do that, you know. And then in my 30s, I was trying to build my business and stuff, and so I really was very happy.
My parents eloped.
Did they?
I think that is so romantic. They eloped in Southern Illinois. I think he was in college and she was in college, and they just fell in love and eloped.
That's nice. And how long were they married?
They were married almost 20 years.
No, what? Your parents were married 20 years?
Yeah, 16 years maybe.
No way.
Yeah, they were married for a long time.
I want to see some dates.
I have to ask her how long they were married.
Well, that's pretty awesome.
They're married for a long time.
Okay. Well, anyway, we should probably stop talking.
Okay, let's stop talking. I say, please watch Snowfall. It's dynamic. I think the love relationships are beautiful. It's great to see. You got to get past the crack stuff, but the storyline is wonderful. The acting is phenomenal. I think
You can't get past the crack stuff.
It's
a show about crack.
No, but you have to get past.
It's called Snowfall. The snow is the crack.
Hold on. You have to get past it to see the beauty in a lot of the conversations, a lot of the relationships. There was a part with this hardcore gangster who you'd be scared of.
Oh, Scully.
Scully. He made these comments that were so deep. He's just like, lady, he's like, you need to have love. You got hate in your heart.
You
need to have more love in your heart. I don't know how they talk back then.
Khadija, why you got so much hate in your heart?
You got so much hate in your heart. You got to slow down. Like, that is just love. And how Khadija was running things. Like, you thought, oh, here's this hardcore gangster. But Khadija, his girl, was running it.
Yes,
it was just dynamic.
She was in mama bear mode. They killed her baby, so she was.
She turned on. So those moments, you can gather inspiration, even in the triflingness.
Marlo's asking: is there any gay stuff in Snowfall? I didn't see any gay stuff.
Whoa!
Oh, wait.
That was a beautiful observation.
No. There was that lesbian thing.
No, there was a lesbian thing, but there was also the rape. Let's not talk about that. That was hard to watch.
That was like a 2-minute scene, though. That wasn't.
Yeah, but that was season one.
That was a guy that walked in the room, something happened, then he comes out zipping up his pants.
There was a rape.
So they didn't really make us endure too much.
Oh my God. You know what? It was more of a prison culture thing that I got.
Yeah, that's what I got too.
I got it as a prison culture, but still. That was there. And there was a lesbian issue, but it wasn't central.
Yeah.
And I think, who's that? Marla made that comment? That's a beautiful observation, because that was something that we did not see prominent. And usually when you see current films involving a cast of Black people, you do see that theme.
The agenda is real.
The agenda is real. It's not nothing against homosexuality. It's just something to highlight the agenda.
Oh, the agenda's real.
And yeah.
And I applaud the Black people who are fighting against the agenda. You know, we should be able to process sexuality in our own way without letting white people drive the bus.
Right. So even gay people think that. They're like, I hate this. Like, they hate the stereotypes
that they see on
TV. So I think it's a beautiful, there's beautiful moments. The acting is phenomenal. I give it, out of 5 stars, how many stars would you give it?
I give it like 4.5.
4.5. Okay. Mm-hmm. I agree.
Yeah.
4.5 star. There were some plot holes. that were never, that didn't make sense to me, that bothered me. Mm-hmm. So it's, you can't get a 5-star because mm-hmm. of that. So it's just like, okay, that doesn't make sense. Okay, that they're not adding that up. Like there was some, there was some storyline holes that bothered me. But other than that, if it didn't have those holes, it would get 5 stars.
Yeah.
But because of that, it's like a 4-star.
It's a good show. It's a really good show.
Yeah.
Well, thank you guys for hanging out. We got to run. We got an appointment in a few minutes. And so it was real. It was great talking to you. And by the way, my Instagram is The Real Boyce Watkins. So follow me on Instagram. Hit the thumbs up button if you could right before you go. Please hit the thumbs up button. And Alicia's Instagram, I'll give you that too. It's Coaching with Dr. Alicia. So feel free to follow her on the gram. All right, guys. Have a good day. God bless you. And we will talk to you soon. Say goodbye.
Goodbye, everyone.
Bye-bye.